Freddie Mercury was one of the rock world's most iconic figures. As the frontman of Queen, his performances electrified audiences worldwide.
There was nobody like him beforehand, and there's been nobody like him since.
But he fiercely guarded his secrecy.
He was quite private in many ways. It is true, he was two very different people.
And the secret Freddie was outrageous.
He wasn't the easiest person in the world. Excuse me, you know, this is not a saint.
And said, darling, my attitude is, fuck it. I'm doing everything with everybody.
But Freddie's risk-taking lifestyle left him exposed.
He was living a very precarious life because AIDS was out there. I mean, he just went wild.
This is the inside story of the Freddie Mercury you never knew.
Everything about him was a secret and a complication.
The behind-the-scenes story of the 2 years in which he achieved his greatest musical triumph, but also faced his deepest fears.
Max,
we'll have this sent round to Harley Street straight away, Freddie.
It's his battle to keep his privacy.
Not to tell a soul. I mean it. Not a soul.
To keep on working.
You all right, Freddie?
Yes, I'm fine, darling. I'm okay.
And the fight of his life.
My old faithful.
The real story of Freddie Mercury, the great pretender. Saturday, the 13th of July, 1985. Queen are backstage at Live Aid, waiting to go on.
How long we got, Peter?
About 5 minutes, I should think.
About 5 minutes?
Yeah.
All right.
I remember Freddie pacing about. Like all of them, they were all nervous. Everybody was nervous. And I think Freddie was concerned because they hadn't played in England for a bit and he wasn't sure how he'd go down.
Bob Geldof and Harvey Goldsmith persuaded Queen to appear at Live Aid, but the band had been in disarray.
I think most people in the business would have agreed that we went into Live Aid thinking that Queen were the classic group who'd had their big hits, were basically over as a group of the present, but were nonetheless a joy to watch.
Freddie had been living in Germany. His newly released solo album, Mr. Bad Guy, had bombed.
That was a real crossroads, I think. It was a real serious chance of them breaking up.
Freddie had also been suffering from a nagging health problem.
Oh, my fucking throat. How is it, Freddie? How's a million-dollar voice?
Never been better, darling.
Just a year before, Freddie's throat had cracked up, forcing Queen to cancel five gigs. At Live Aid, he's singing against his doctor's advice.
Ready to go, guys? You're on at 6:40. Let's go steal the show, darlings. Remember, you've got 18 minutes, all right? Let's do this. Let's go!
Come on, boys!
Woo! Go on, boys!
When he came out the porter cabin, he had his little shuffle where he used to do his little punch of his arms and everything. You knew he was ready. And when he got on stage, you could tell he was ready.
Freddie bounded onto the stage, full of energy, greeting the crowd with trademark fist pumps, a wave, and a toothy grin.
Came on like a star, you know, and they reacted to him.
Sat down at that piano and played the opening chords of Bohemian Rhapsody. A record that everybody knows. It was an extraordinary moment.
of us. We all stopped to watch because we were mesmerised.
The 72,000 crowd and 1.9 billion TV audience saw Freddie give the performance of his life.
I mean, I remember being on stage trying to capture the vastness of the crowd, and Freddie there, you know, doing his thing across the stage was quite incredible.
When he talks about it being the greatest live performance ever, it was of its moment. It just worked. It worked brilliantly.
And as soon as they went off stage, you just knew that they'd stolen the show. There was just this energy. It was just fantastic.
Freddie triumphed at Live Aid.
We killed it!
Did you hear what Elton said? He said we stole the show. What time is he on? Have we missed him?
No, he's later. Yeah. Not to Bowie.
Yeah. That was great.
They went on Giants, they come off Monsters.
After Live Aid, Queen were firmly back on the map.
They realised that they were greater than the sum of their parts. They still have what it took to go out there and were given this second wind. They could go out there and be Queen again.
The magic's back.
I just had a word with the guys. We're back tomorrow. Just us.
None of them knew at that time that this new lease of life would be so tragically short-lived.
Live Aid was the unexpected rebirth of the band. But just around the corner, disaster was waiting.
And at that moment, I had that sinking feeling. And that sinking feeling is a real feeling. I thought to myself, we're going to lose Freddie.
Within 2 years, Freddie will be fighting for his life.
It was such bad luck, such terrible bad luck.
Fred was frail. He was seriously frail. And it was sad, very sad.
Live Aid gave Freddie Mercury and Queen a massive career boost.
Post Live Aid in 85, they suddenly had this resurgence. So suddenly they had the opportunity to play anywhere they liked. And so at this point, they couldn't do anything wrong.
Their set list had included some of their greatest hits. But it was Bohemian Rhapsody, written by Freddie, that ignited the crowd.
Bohemian Rhapsody, well, yeah, it's, I guess, the song that everybody associates with Queen, and certainly with Freddie. It was his creation, totally.
1975, London. Freddie was 29 when he wrote Bohemian Rhapsody. It was the record which catapulted Queen from rock stars to rock gods.
He had the vision, he believed in it, and there was also, certainly, I think, the feeling that if that hadn't been a hit, that probably EMI would have dropped them at that point.
Can we just get a level off you, please, Freddie?
OK.
That was their fourth album. They had huge success. They'd had success, but they weren't really breaking through the way that they could have done.
OK, that's great, thank you. And we're rolling tape. This is Bohemian Rhapsody, solo vocal, Freddie Mercury, take six.
My reaction to Bohemian Rhapsody, like most other people at EMI, was just, OK, what do we do with this? It's 7.5 minutes long, and that doesn't go on the radio. You know, it's an extraordinary piece of music. We got no idea what to do with it.
I think with Freddie, he just never even thought about that. He's just, you know, I'm going to do what I do, what I believe in. Just killed a man, put a gun against his head, pulled my trigger, now he's... And he just went in there, wrote the stuff, sang it, recorded it, performed it, and did, as he always did all through his life and his career, he did the best he could. It was always quality and style, darling. It has to be quality and style.
Freddie was then living with girlfriend Mary Austin. They'd been together 5 years.
Mary was like a doll, Mary Austin. She was blonde and had huge eyes, and she worked at Bieber, so she was into all the fashion side of things.
She was a very sweet, trustworthy person, devoted to him.
When I first met Mary, she was charming. We got on very well, and I liked her, and she was always generous of spirit. Beautiful. She was beautiful. She's delicate and gorgeous. Most lovely face. Beautiful eyes. No, she was gorgeous.
Vodka and tonic?
Oh, I get two.
How are you?
Good to see you.
How are you? Two vodka and tonics, darling.
Ice and a slice.
Lovely. Thank you.
Are you, with anybody this evening?
I'm actually with my girlfriend, darling.
Thank you.
What a waste.
There you are, Mary.
To meet your friend.
I've never seen him before, just some guy.
Freddie was in a relationship with Mary, but hiding a secret from her.
He'd experimented with other boys at school. He'd had, not relationships, but liaisons, I think you'd have to call them. And he'd always known that he was more attracted to boys than to girls. He was wrestling with himself. He wasn't honest with her for a long time. But she had her suspicions. He loved her. But he realized that his sexuality was taking him in another direction. And he couldn't live with himself anymore. But there came a turning point for him when he realized, he knew, I've got to be honest with this woman because she's pledged her life to me.
Freddie, are you awake? I made tea. Do you want it in bed or are you getting up? Tea.
Oh, thank you, darling.
He faced a choice, to come clean or live a lie.
Sleep okay? Are you okay? You seem a bit off with me.
You can talk to me now, Freddie.
It's nothing.
Well, it must be something. You can tell me now. I'm not stupid.
I do love you, Mary. I mean, I just don't think I can go on pretending like this anymore.
So, are you telling me you're gay?
Mary was fine with it. She used to go out with us a lot of times, and a whole group of us, and not just homosexuals or gay people. I mean, Mary was quite resilient. And carried on. She always adored Freddie, and Freddie adored her.
They remained very close for the rest of his life. But now, Freddie was free to fully explore his true sexuality. '79, New York. Away from the publicity glare of London, Freddie was drawn to New York City, where he could anonymously enjoy the thriving gay scene.
Do you fancy a drink? Come on, come and meet Freddie.
With Freddie was Paul Prenter. He joined Queen's management in 1977.
Freddie? This is James. Hi.
Sorry, I'll be the dear.
Do you want a drink?
Yes.
He was described by drummer Roger Taylor as a very subversive influence.
Paul, I don't know what agenda he had. I do think he was very fond of Freddie, very fond of Freddie, and Freddie was fond of him. But he certainly seemed to be able to lead Freddie or to go against certain things. But because we were all friends and you went along with Paul, I think Freddie relied on him a lot. He made himself indispensable.
One of his main roles was scoring cocaine and willing male partners for Freddie.
Took to the gay scene in New York in such a big way, and the tragedy of that really was that it was so raw. It was a very much an anything went kind of world, and there was a lot seedy about it. Some of those clubs, the gay clubs, and I did go to a couple of them, they were, I'm not easily shocked, but they were pretty shocking places. And I think he became addicted to all of that. It was one extreme to the other, and he was an extreme person.
Freddie's first love was still music, and Queen still recorded, jetting between New York, Montreux, and Munich, where they produced Crazy Little Thing Called Love. The song's a simple rock and roll homage from the album The Game. And the video, shot to accompany it, shows Freddie rocking a new look.
Crazy Little Thing was done when we were at the end of a tax exile year in Munich. That was 1979, and then what followed became their biggest ever album, number one singles in America, triple platinum albums, huge tours, and that's when they were the biggest band in the world.
Soon after, Freddie took his new look one step further by embracing the iconic image originally made famous by the Village People's Glenn Hughes.
Obviously, the image changed into the shorter hair, the tash, and other types of clothing from specialist stores. And he'd just grown this tash, and we just thought, what the fuck are you doing, Fred? You know, I mean, really? And he said, look, I want to see how I look. Take a photograph. And I got my camera, and I was doing shots of the band anyway. Put a Polaroid back on, shot it, pulled it out. So there you go, Fred. Oh, yes, I look bloody wonderful, don't I?
Some of us hate it, Queen's John Deacon told Rolling Stone. But that's him, and you can't stop it. He publicly debuts his new look in the video promo for the 1980 Queen single, Play the Game. Written by Freddie, the lyrics seem to sum up his uninhibited attitude to sex.
Sex played a very important part in his life. He was very sexually driven. He was a young, healthy man then, you know, so it's natural. And he discovered a new life, and he was going to live it to the full, and did.
The As Freddie's enjoying the New York gay scene, the first reports of a mysterious disease targeting the city's gay community start to surface.
So there was a couple of reports predominantly arising from physicians who were looking after people in the gay community in the east and west coast of the United States, of people who became unwell with weakened immune systems and having infections or tumours that were caused by infectious agents.
An article in the New York Times reported 41 cases of a rare and often rapidly fatal form of cancer.
These people were very rapidly sick with other illnesses and died, and there was a mystery about what was going on and causing these problems.
And then suddenly, word starts getting around. People are dying for some sexually transmitted new disease. Didn't have a name yet. People weren't sure what it was that was unsafe at first.
In the early days, we didn't know the causative agent, and we didn't know how that causative agent was transmitted, so we couldn't give advice to people on how to protect themselves.
Initially, the killer disease was only known to a few specialist doctors and public healthcare officials. They called it GRID, gay-related immune deficiency. Later, it was renamed AIDS. No one yet knew it was caused by a retrovirus, transmitted by the exchange of bodily fluids, mainly during sex.
Many people caught a fatal virus without even knowing the virus existed. They caught the disease when there was no such thing as safe sex, because nobody knew there was any such thing as unsafe sex.
In New York City, gay men partied on, obliviously.
I think Freddie really was doing everything with everybody.
The damage was already done before he knew the damage could be done.
September 1985, Munich, Germany. 2 months after Live Aid, Queen were back in the studio, working on a new album and planning a European tour for the following summer.
I think for this, if you're going to use it, it has a cymbal smash. The jungle rhythm should come out of cymbal smash. You know?
Okay.
And in his downtime, Freddie took to Munich in a big way.
Freddie had become very immersed in the gay scene there, which was like a mini New York. And there was an area that was referred to as the Bermuda Triangle, where all the gay clubs were. And there was a very vibrant gay scene, which he became addicted to. It was all about clubbing and drugging and drinking every night.
At Freddie's side was his ever-present personal manager, Paul Prenter.
Paul Prenter was mainly looking after the, how did Reddy call it, the ginger area. They called going out to gay clubs going ginging. Yeah, I guess you had to be there.
See a blue Brinton. Hey, Freddie!
Hello, Roger.
How are you? How's it going, guys? We're having a beer here. You going to join us?
No, no, no. We've got plans.
Perhaps we can come along.
I don't think it'll be quite your thing. Freddie
with his guys would go off and they'd be finding their own entertainment, and the rest of the band would go off in other directions, and never the twain shall meet. Within their inner circle, it was the PPP and the HH. It was the presidential pouf de parler and the heterosexual Hilton.
But it was a risky time to be a gay man. Since the outbreak of AIDS in the US, the disease had spread worldwide. And by 1983, scientists recognized it was caused by a retrovirus and had discovered it could be spread through sex.
Once the virus was isolated, we were then able to understand the mechanisms by which it was transmitted: sexual, injection drug use, blood products such as transfusions or to hemophiliacs, and then we were able to give people advice on how to protect themselves.
But Freddie brushed the danger aside.
He was living a very precarious life because he was, doing so much of everything, and people were worried about him, and several friends did warn him about, taking care because of, AIDS was out there. But he said, oh, don't worry, I'm not going to make old bones anyway.
In the gay clubs of Munich, Freddie ignored the possibility he might become, or already be, HIV positive. In fact, he was spreading his affections around quite freely with the help of an unusual accomplice.
Barbara Valentin was a sex symbol in Germany. They called her the Brigitte Bardot of Germany. Now she was in her middle years, but still trying to be very sexy. She showed him the Munich nightlife.
It was basically what Freddie needed, you know, a door opener. It was convenient. And she was situated in the gay community as Big Mama, giving him access to everything he wanted. And Barbara was the worst influence Freddie ever had.
Freddie and Barbara shared a Munich flat and, seemingly, much more.
Did you sleep well?
Yes, I did, my darling. Thank you very much. Danke schön, mein Liebling.
Barbara was very open with me about the sexual relationship she had with Freddie, and quite often that involved other people as well, other men, other women. There would be a number of them in the bedroom at any given time, and in fact they were raided by the police once, and the police did storm into their room and found more people than they were expecting to find in the bed that morning.
She didn't mind what she did, you know, really, with the boys. She wanted to get to Freddie, so if he to have him have fun, she joined in. You know. I walked in on one, I must say. But I didn't stay. I was invited to, but I decided to go and have a cup of tea.
Party to these fun threesomes was Freddie's new Munich-based boyfriend, Winnie Kirschberger.
Winnie Kirschberger to Freddie, I think he was a big sex scene, really. Winnie didn't speak any English, and Freddie didn't speak any German, so how deep is your love? How sophisticated is that love affair going to be? Not really. I think it was primarily founded on sex.
Only the complications of Freddie's sex life didn't end in Munich. Just a few months before Live Aid, Freddie had met 36-year-old Jim Hutton.
Can I buy you a drink?
No, I've got one, thanks. Let me buy you a drink.
All right, lovely. Vodka and tonic.
I'll have a vodka and tonic too, please.
How big's your cock? Jim is a very ordinary guy who was from Ireland, and he was very masculine looking, the type that Freddie liked. You know, he liked an ordinary guy. He thought they were attractive because they were normal, what you would call normal, whatever normal is.
Hello, Jim. It's Freddie, darling.
Freddie? Ah, Freddie. How are you?
I was wondering why you haven't called.
Oh, well, now, you know how it is.
And I was wondering, are we going to see each other again?
Well, sure.
Would you like to come to dinner tonight? There's just a few of us.
Sure.
Jim was a good bloke, and he was a character in his own right, and I think made him a lot different to a lot of people Fred met.
Clive's done such a great cook. No formal training, just all natural flair. Have a seat, darling.
Why, Lazy, is that his real name?
No. No, his real name is Joe Finelli. I call him Liza Minnelli, because I absolutely adore her.
Okay. And what's Phoebe's real name, then?
Phoebe's real name is Peter. I give all my friends little nicknames.
Great. And do they have one for you, then?
They do. They call me Melina.
Melina?
Yes, after Melina Mercury, the singer. You know what, darling? I think we should give you a nickname as well.
Freddie nicknamed Jim Lauren, after the actress Lauren Hutton. A few months later, he flew him to Munich for his 39th birthday party, an outrageous black and white ball at a local nightclub, Henderson's.
He said to me, I want you to come to Munich because it's my birthday and we're going to have a drag ball. It's going to be fabulous. Everybody's coming in drag. I said, hey, Freddie, it's not a problem. He said, everybody. I said, no, it's okay, man. Everybody. The funny thing was that everybody was in drag except for Freddie, because he turns up dressed as a mannequin, you know, and, you know, in this one-piece mannequin suit, and I'm going, oh, thanks a lot.
It was a huge event. Guests included Freddie's Munich record producer, Reinhold Mack, and Queen's longtime lawyer and business advisor, Jim Beach.
Freddie's 39th birthday, he wanted to have a big do, and there was Jim Beach saying, if we incorporate this into birthday filming video, then it's tax deductible and we just spend it all.
The extravaganza cost £50,000 and went down in rock and roll folklore.
The party was an extraordinary event. I've never been to a party like it, and I've been to a lot of rock and roll parties. It was amazing. Everybody got so much champagne and vodka. I mean, everybody got absolutely blotto. It was terrific. It's just pure luxury.
The party was filmed for the music video for Freddie's solo single, Living on My Own. Freddie lip-synced to the track at the party venue, alone. The promo emphasized Freddie's sense of loneliness. With or without people, he still felt on his own. Yet Freddie isn't all alone at the party. The footage revealing he enjoyed having new lover Jim around. But also lurking in the footage was Paul Prenter.
At the party, I remember Prenter gave Freddie something just before he cut his cake. And you see, Freddie told me a moment earlier, he said, I can't see, I'm blind. And, you know, I was just going to say, don't be ridiculous, where I realized that he wasn't seeing anything. You know, he was, how do you call them, poppers, or, you know, amyl nitrate or something. It was something totally stupid.
Freddie just about managed to blow out his candles, but Prenter had to help steady him. It was a legendary 39th birthday party that epitomized his lifestyle.
Everybody was dancing. I mean, some people were almost naked. They came as these famous people, but they were almost naked. And certainly by the end of the evening, they were almost naked. I mean, it did look like something like the fall of the Roman Empire, the last party, you know.
Only the party was about to come to an abrupt halt. Soon after his birthday, the Queen frontman made a sudden decision to quit Munich and head home to England.
He left suddenly without telling anybody, and he didn't even tell Barbara, who he was living with. He just went. He drew a line under that mad life, and he came back to England and he started again.
His return to England may have been connected to his health. According to Barbara Valentin, Freddie may have suspected in Munich that he was HIV positive.
There was an occasion when he cut his hand on a razor in the bathroom. He screamed, she came rushing in and tried to help him, and she got blood all over her, and he was yelling at her to get out, get out, get out. And she said, I realized, I knew that he knew, and he knew that I knew. And she said, we never discussed it. But from then on, we never had sex again.
And his friends were increasingly worried about him and his potential exposure to the virus.
I ran into Freddie, as I often did at the Club Heaven, and I said to him in the Star Bar, have you altered your behavior in light of the new disease? And that's when he did his flourish of his arms and said, darling, my attitude is, fuck it, I'm doing everything with everybody. And I did have that sinking feeling. There is such a thing as that sinking feeling. And I just thought, we're going to lose Freddie. Because no matter what he did to change his act now, it had already happened without him even knowing it could happen.
So had Freddie come home to face a secret battle and the fight of his life? According to his sometime lover, Barbara Valentin, Freddie Mercury left Munich suspecting he was HIV positive.
It wasn't a diagnosis, but he'd had a test, although that was never admitted or announced. But when he discovered that he was infected, he came back to England.
But other friends believed there was another reason for his quick departure.
Freddie got bored with Munich, as simple as that. Freddie could get bored very quickly, actually. And so he was always looking for some new excitement.
Whatever the reason, in 1985, Freddie moved into a new home.
Beautiful, darling. All right, darling, let's have a look.
Garden Lodge, a 28-room Georgian mansion.
Oh, it's lovely, darling.
Secluded behind brick walls in the heart of central London.
It was quite an elegant-looking house, quite a desirable house. It had been owned by a member of the Hoare banking family, and Freddie delighted in calling it the Hoare House.
The move was managed by his former girlfriend and now PA, Mary Austin.
It was Mary's project, really. She found the house, and she oversaw all the building work and all the renovations and all the new fixtures and fittings.
Mary had been at Freddie's side for 15 years.
It's beautiful.
Also moving into Garden Lodge was Jim Hutton, the new man in his life.
It's amazing. It's absolutely beautiful. Look at it. What do you think? Beautiful. All right, let me show you the rest of it.
Freddie was always looking for somebody to love. The nice thing about Jim coming to his life, he found someone who was solid and loyal, and they got on, and they just hit it off. And it was a time when I think Freddie was ready to settle.
October 1985, London. News of a friend's death rocks his newfound happiness.
Rock Hudson arrived in Hollywood in the late 1940s. He was born Roy Shearer Jr.
Rock Hudson was one of the first celebrities to die from AIDS.
Did you know him?
Roy?
Yes, well, I met him.
There was no hiding his physical deterioration when he showed up recently for a promotional launch for a new Doris Day.
It was chilling news. And a warning to Freddie that his promiscuous past might catch up with him.
When somebody acquires HIV, they may have a short flu-like illness a few weeks after that, and then they go into a period where they're often well for a number of years without knowing that anything is going on. Then maybe 4 or 5 years after infection, they might get some minor symptoms, and then somewhere around 8 to 10 years after infection, on average, they'd start to get more serious infection and risk of death.
Freddie's GP was Dr. Gordon Atkinson.
Ah, Freddie. Delighted to see you, dear boy. Do have a seat.
Thank you, Doctor.
So, how have you been?
I feel fine.
Well, I just wanted to have a look at that throat of yours. Okay. Now, open wide.
His persistent sore throat that had troubled him at Live Aid and before could be a symptom of the early onset of AIDS.
The first infections are mild and quite treatable. They might then start to develop some mild symptoms, skin problems, maybe thrush, and then have some first opportunistic infections or cancers that mark out AIDS.
Ah,
How's it been, eh? Mm. Any sensitivities? Mm-mm. Any weight loss?
No, none.
Right, Freddie. Have you thought about a test for HIV?
In 1986, many people avoided taking an HIV test for good reason.
We had a test available from 1984, but of course we didn't have any treatment available at that time. So many people didn't come forward to testing because to some degree it was pointless. You found out that you had something that you couldn't do anything about, so why test?
The HIV thing, you don't think it will touch you, or we just think it's not going to hit us.
In the period before 1995, when the introduction of combination therapies made AIDS survivable, it was a death sentence. If you had developed AIDS, you would die.
June 1986. Work had finished on Queen's new album, A Kind of Magic, and the band were back on tour. It was a massive venture, 26 dates, performing to over a million people. It was a huge undertaking for Freddie, particularly with the growing concerns around his health. In an interview filmed to promote the tour, he admitted that he was now finding live performance exhausting.
It's been a while since we actually did a tour. It's very, very exhausting for me to do what I have to do. The stages are getting bigger and everything, and you know, and I just like to feel that I'm perfectly fit to do these shows, and not just sort of say, yes, I'll do it.
Those close to Freddie on the Magic Tour began to notice a change in him.
There were periods of time when he was just not the same. He wasn't right, and you could see there was something wrong, but we didn't really think about it. And to be frank with you, none of us really understood what AIDS was, what it was about, how it worked, what it did to the body. We just didn't know that much about it. I mean, bodily, he must have known that he wasn't right.
Budapest. 7 weeks into the tour, the normally tight-lipped Freddie was caught off guard by a Hungarian reporter.
At the beginning of your friendship with Hungary and with Budapest, and it may last long, as long as Queen will last.
If I'm still alive, I will come back.
You know. Thank you very much. Okay. Thank you. Fine.
A throwaway remark or a sign of a deeper worry?
Oh, that's great. I wish all interviews were that short.
The Magic Tour climaxed at an open-air concert in Nebworth, Hertfordshire.
Towards the end, before we did Nebworth, no one was talking about it, but we all kind of knew that Freddie was not well. No one knew how not well he was or what it was, and there were whispers and whatever, and we just kind of trucked along as if it kind of it would get better, if you like.
It's a huge.
Have a good one out there, right?
This is the one, Freddie.
Enjoy it.
Who's the voice, Freddie?
Oh, you know, darling. Same old, same old. The show must go on, darling.
We blanked out his illness. It was like, well, clearly he's ill, but he'll be all right because it's Fred. I knew he was ill, but I didn't know specifically with what. But you obviously thought you... torching you.
Freddie started the show in good form, singing One Vision. But by the last song, We Are the Champions, his voice and performance was drained of its usual power.
Well done, guys.
Oh.
Let's go. We've
got
a whole tour to put together.
Ready?
Take off.
No.
Yeah, I'll be right there. I'll join you right there.
You're right, Freddie?
Yeah, Brian, I'm good. I'll see you out there. I'll be right behind you. All right.
Come on.
Come on. You okay?
I'm really tired. I'm not feeling it.
You want to go home?
Let's go.
The truth was, obviously, he wasn't that well, and he was starting to slip a bit, and he wasn't the same party animal that he was, and whatever, and he kept up a brave face, but clearly it was difficult.
Freddie ducked out of the end of tour party. Nebworth would be his last ever Queen gig. He had not yet been diagnosed as HIV positive, and he hadn't confided his fears to Jim or anyone else.
He was in denial at that point, I'm pretty sure. You know, he did have this thing about himself. He said, I would never make old bones. He always thought he was going to die relatively young.
September 7th, 1986, London. Freddie's 40th birthday party, a Mad Hatter's party at Garden Lodge, was quieter than his 39th.
Jesus, I look like some kind of idiot in this.
Oh, don't be silly, darling. Let me get something for you. Hang on. There you are. That's something a bit more you, Jim.
I know why you like this one.
I know. I love it. You look ravishing, but no one could look more ravishing than me on my 40th birthday.
What time's everyone coming?
Oh, they're getting here around, I think, 6 or 7 or something like that, I think.
Freddie and Jim have now been together for over a year.
Goodness, darling, what is this?
Open it and see.
Oh, my goodness. Oh, Jim, it's absolutely beautiful.
It's like the wedding ring. Yeah, pass your right hand. In the name of the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. Amen. See, it's official.
Oh, my goodness, Jim, it's beautiful. I absolutely love it.
Jim gave Fred the love that he hadn't had for a long time. As a straight guy, I think it was love.
And Freddie later confirmed his commitment to Jim in an interview with journalist friend David Wigg.
I'm very happy with my relationship at the moment. Mm. And I couldn't ask for better. So I finally found a niche that I was looking for all my life.
At the end of September, he and Jim took a long holiday to Japan.
Japan was not so much a honeymoon, but it was, this is our break together, and we do what we want to do together. It was the period before the bad news was going to hit, and he was in a good place because he was very, very happy with Jim, and life seemed good.
But before he went to Japan, Freddie took an HIV test.
Just a scratch. Okay? Ready? Just relax, Freddie. There we go. Relax. Relax. Freddie, good? Excellent. There we go. You hold that in place for me, please. Thank you. We'll have this sent round to Harley Street straight away, Freddie. It's a simple precaution. I know it's for the best.
Dr. Atkinson sent the blood sample to a Harley Street pathology clinic. While Freddie was in Japan, news of the HIV test leaked out. Jim Beach, Queen's manager.
Is that Mr. Beach?
Yes, this is Jim Beach.
I'm calling from the News of the World regarding Freddie Mercury.
Go on.
Have you got any comment on Freddie having an AIDS test?
What? Who is this?
Freddie Mercury being tested for AIDS. Have you any comment?
Where on earth have you come from with this?
A test performed in a Harley Street clinic, Mr. Beach. Can you confirm that?
Off the record, I'd be very careful if I were printing that kind of unfounded nonsense.
We're running the story, Mr. Beach.
We'll be issuing a statement. Good day. Where's Freddie?
October 12th. The News of the World ran the HIV test story. It quoted Freddie's spokesman, confirming he's concerned, which is why he took the test. October 13th. The next day, Freddie and Jim flew in from Japan, and the press were waiting to pounce.
Have you had an AIDS test, Freddie?
I'm perfectly fit, thank you very much.
Are you concerned about your health, Freddie?
I'll see you, boss.
I used to have reporters at the airport, but we had someone at the house as well. Just after that period of the Japan trip, reporter come to the door as we was going in with a photographer, and obviously there was no comment.
The News of the World's sister paper, The Sun, printed his denials the next day. Freddie did not have AIDS, but his blood tests would reveal if he had the HIV virus that led to the disease. October 13th, 1986. Freddie Mercury flies home to London from a trip to Japan. Whilst he's away, news breaks he's had an HIV test.
We're running the story, Mr. Beach.
We'll be issuing a statement. Good day.
Just a few days later, he's visited by an old lover from his days in New York, John Murphy.
Hello, John, darling. Phoebe, would you mind getting us some tea, please, darling?
John, thank you.
How's James?
Oh, my gosh, John. Take a seat, darling.
Freddie, it's good to see you, man. You look well.
I feel good. I'm fine.
As you can see, I'm not so good. You know what it is, Freddie. I've been living with that. I'm dying, Freddie. Doctors say I got months, weeks even.
John.
And James. He's dying too. It's a race to see who goes first.
John Murphy died of AIDS on the 11th of November, 1986. His partner, James Weinthorpe, a few weeks later. The first of Freddie's lovers to succumb. And two of over 16,000 AIDS deaths to that date in the US alone.
Our hospital wards in central London were full of people who were sick and many of those individuals were dying, we saw a community being wiped out.
Well, that was the period of when a lot of people that you know, one knows and that and you're close to, had contacted HIV and were dying with AIDS. My wife and I had a lot of gay friends who were dying, and it was very, very sad. Very sad time.
Freddie, hoping he'd escaped infection, had already had an HIV test.
Freddie, we've had the results back from the clinic. It's not good news, I'm afraid. You're carrying the HIV virus. I'm most dreadfully sorry, Freddie. Please, please take a moment, my boy.
How long have I got, Doctor?
It's hard to say. It's not necessarily the case that it will lead to AIDS. We do know of people who don't develop it. But in most cases, the AIDS will develop up to 10 years from the original infection.
There was hope. There are small numbers of people in the population who are genetically immune or resistant to the acquisition of HIV infection. There is a very small number of people who acquire HIV infection but never seem to get sick as a result of it because they control it with their immune system.
February 1987, London. Freddie hoped for the best and kept his condition a secret.
I asked him, I said, do you have AIDS or HIV? And he said no, he had some blood condition. He actually answered that to me. And I said, well, you will let me know if there's anything and whatever. And he never let on to me.
He was determined to keep on working.
Yes, Great Pretender, vocal track one.
From now on, much of Freddie's life was a great pretense.
And Freddie said, this song, for me, is one that I would like to have written myself about me, the Great Pretender, because what you see is not actually what, you know, that's not me 100%. There's another song here, but I'm the Great Pretender, and this is what I do for a living, and I'm pretty good at it.
Before shooting the video for Great Pretender, Freddie decided on a change of image.
Is it coming off, Freddy?
What do you think?
The Great Pretender, finally unmasked.
It's got to go. It must be done, darling.
You look weird. Oh, wow. This I've got to see. I'm gonna feel naked, Freddy.
The moustache, grown in 1980, had powerfully identified Freddie with an iconic image of gay masculinity. Now, 7 years on, he abandoned the look.
You look about 14 years old, Freddie.
I look bloody beautiful. That's what I look like, darling.
Modest as ever.
The moustache gone, the new-look Freddie made a dynamic appearance. Freddie's friend, Peter Straker, was also asked to shave for the shoot.
The Great Pretender, yes. I had a moustache as well, I still have one, a little tash, little thing like this. And we'd all shaved, and Freddie shaved. But he hadn't shaved under his arms, and I was really pissed off. No, not really, but just as a joke.
A tiring all-night video shoot with multiple costume and set changes was a tough test of Freddie's health, but he got through it.
He didn't just sing the song, he became the Great Pretender. If you look at the video, only Fred could make an entrance like that. It's extraordinary. He loved it. I mean, it was him.
The Great Pretender performed with no sign of fatigue or illness, and no one suspected a thing.
The Great Pretender was great fun. to do. I didn't know for a long time, or hadn't guessed, that Freddie might be suffering from the virus.
You look at the sort of the video, The Great Pretender, looks like a Superman to me. Sounded like Superman, behaved like Superman.
But behind Freddie's pretense, there were, in early 1987, signs that his immune system was losing the fight against HIV.
Tea, my darling.
Kaposi sarcoma was perhaps the most stigmatizing infection or tumour associated with HIV infection because it caused red or purple spots on the skin. Kaposi sarcoma is caused by a member of the herpes virus family. It's a relatively common infection, but of course it doesn't manifest in people who have a healthy immune system. It's only when the immune system is down that it takes the opportunity to create these tumours.
Well, of course, could be a whole host of different things. Okay, there we go. I think just to be on the safe side, we ought to have it checked out. Right, Freddie, now. This won't hurt a bit. Hang on. There we go. Splendid. Just put a couple of stitches in that and you'll be as right as rain.
When we see a skin lesion that is suspicious of being Kaposi sarcoma, typically at the time we would do a biopsy of it, and then under the microscope it has characteristic appearances that enable the diagnosis to be confirmed. So the diagnosis of Kaposi sarcoma was typically a point of saying this person had become ill, had a weak immune system, and they were likely to get further illnesses down the line.
Hello, Mary?
Yes, Mary speaking.
Mary, this is Dr. Atkinson.
Oh, hello.
Mary, it's about Freddie.
Yes?
Yeah? Yes. Mary, please get him to come and see me at once.
Okay, I'm seeing him later. I'll see what I can do.
Thank you, Mary. Good to see you again, Freddie. The biopsy results are back. Unfortunately, it does confirm that the lump on your shoulder is a Kaposi sarcoma. For I know it's frightful for you. It's not without hope, Freddy. There are new drugs in the pipeline that...
In the mid-80s, we were working on antiviral drugs. AZT was the first drug approved for treatment of HIV infection. It was shown to prolong life in people who already were sick with HIV infection. So it wasn't without hope that people had, because some people were slow in progression of their disease, and that there was a hope that people could remain alive until we established much better treatments for the disease. The idea was to buy time while we came up with better things to treat the infection.
I believe Freddie felt, to begin with, that he could be cured, and he saw a lot of different doctors and spent a lot of money. I don't think at that stage he thought he was going to die from it.
Freddie Mercury had tested positive for HIV.
The biopsy report is back. It confirms that the lump on your shoulder is a Kaposi sarcoma.
And was diagnosed with an AIDS-defining illness. Easter 1987. With no known cure and his physical decline inevitable, Freddie reluctantly told those closest to him.
What is it, Freddie? What's going on? They've had to take a lump out of me, darling, so they could test it.
What for?
Look, I'll show you. They've... just on the top there, you can see they've put some stitches in there. Can you see it?
Okay, so what are we talking about?
Jim, I don't know how to say this. I've got AIDS. I've got it.
Don't be ridiculous. Like, you're not sick.
Jim...
We can get a second opinion. And...
No, darling. They know it, and I know it. And that's it. I've got it. I've got AIDS.
Well, we can get a second opinion.
Jim. Darling, I'm fucking exhausted. Please, no more, all right?
Once he's told Jim, Freddie told others in his family at Garden Lodge.
I was in the kitchen with him, having a cup of tea, and he actually made me a cup of tea, and Fred couldn't make tea. It was terrible. And sort of sat there and said, look, it's full-blown, and I wanted to tell you myself. I don't know if I was in the room. It was like a sort of a glazed look. I wasn't looking at Fred properly. It was very surreal and never been in that situation with people before, I suppose. And, yeah, and give him a cuddle, said sorry. That was it.
Please take a seat. I've got some news for you. And, I'm afraid it's not good news. I had a growth removed from my shoulder, and Gordon, Dr. Atkinson, arranged to have it tested. And I'm afraid the tests have shown that I have AIDS.
Oh, Freddie.
No. What?
God, Freddie, poor thing.
Yeah, I don't know what to say.
You're not to tell a soul. I mean it. Not a soul. If anyone asks, you say, Freddie, AIDS? That's ridiculous, darlings. He's as fit as a fiddle.
That's all you have to say.
His friends closely guarded his secret.
Whatever was said or told in the house stayed with me. I didn't. When we had the news of Fred had HIV, I didn't even tell my wife.
Freddie also confided in journalist friend David Wigg.
So I asked him if he'd had the test, and he said yes, he had, and he said it was not good news. So I knew what he meant. It was such a shock and so upsetting.
David Wigg never revealed Freddie's secret, but colleagues in the press continued to probe. May 1987, London.
Freddie?
Yes, Phoebe, what is it?
You've got to see this.
The Sun had led with revelations that two of Freddie's lovers, Tony Bastin and John Murphy, had died of AIDS.
Where the fuck do they get this from? Oh, my God. It's John and Tony.
The report went on. Now Mercury, who has slept with hundreds of homosexuals, is terrified that he may develop the dreadful disease. The revelations came from Paul Prenter, Freddie's former manager. Out of work since Queen stopped touring, he sold the story for £32,000. The tabloid press hadn't yet discovered that Freddie had AIDS, but the signs were beginning to show. Sores that wouldn't heal. One on the bottom of his right foot, the other on his right calf. Freddie was still working. At a live performance of Barcelona with opera singer Montserrat Caballé, he's singing well. But Mike Moran, the producer of Barcelona, suspected Freddie was unwell.
I became aware that there were more issues involved, there were more visits to the doctors. I'm not very well today, I've had this, you know. But Fred was never really one to give too many details about it. Barcelona! So, certainly from my point of view, we all went into a bit of denial and carried on as normal.
After nearly 2 years apart, Queen reconvened in Montreux to record a new album, The Miracle.
I think you've all probably guessed what's going on.
What is it, Freddie?
Well, look, I don't think there's any other way to say this, but, so I'm just going to come straight out and say it.
It's AIDS, darling.
I've got AIDS.
Fred, I'm so sorry.
God, Freddie. How long have you known?
I don't want to talk about it, Brian. Listen, whatever happens, it's not going to stop me from working, all right? We've got so much to do. And we're just going to keep working. I'm not going to stop. I will work till I drop.
Yes.
All right?
Yes.
Yeah. And that's it.
That's what we're going to do. Right, guys?
Thank you.
I've had this conversation with Brian many times. You know, why'd you lie? He said, well, we had to. And he was our friend, and we had to protect him. That was his own private life, and he didn't want people to know. He especially didn't want his mum and dad to know. So he kept his secret, and we all kept it for him.
March 1989. During filming for the promo to accompany the first single from the album, I Want It All, Freddie was sporting a beard. The new look was to cover up the Kaposi sarcoma marks on his jawline.
Good. Clean.
9 months later, in what was now a rare public appearance, Freddie looked pallid and thin and didn't even speak as Queen picked up an award for top band of the 80s.
You just went, this is a man who looks very, very unwell. And you sort of feared for the worst. Other people, one had seen suffer with AIDS and the impact that it had and, you know, how a body deteriorated, you know, and looked gaunt and looked thin and looked ill. And Freddie just looked, you know, an ill man, and your heart went out to him.
Freddie had a catheter inserted, allowing him to be treated in the privacy of Garden Lodge.
The nurse is here to see you.
Oh, thank you so much, darling.
Morning, Freddie.
Hello, darling. How are you?
I'm good, thank you. How are you today?
I felt better, darling. I can tell you that much.
You look okay today.
Oh.
You look well.
Thank you.
I'm just going to pop this under your tongue like normal.
He got regular blood transfusions and intravenous drugs, including AZT, the only treatment then licensed to slow the rate of deterioration in AIDS patients.
Good. Thank you.
He'd also signed up for the trial of a new antiretroviral drug, DDI, run by Dr. Graham Moyle.
So, Phoebe, the Ceptrin.
The drug was generally offered to people who'd failed on AZT before, so they'd had it, and either they were no longer getting an apparent benefit from it, or they'd had a side effect that was so severe that they'd had to stop the drug. This represented an alternative to AZT.
How have you been eating today, Freddie?
I've had some breakfast.
So the aim of the trial was to buy more time for the individual by controlling the virus a little bit better for a little bit longer.
But Freddie still had to go to hospital for some treatments.
Okay, Terry. Let's go, please.
It was hard on him, yeah. And this treatment was seriously painful for him. We would go at 5:30 in the morning to have these treatments. It was done that, so there was minimal fuss, because it would be uproar if Fred was sitting in the waiting room. There'd be untold people sitting in there, and yet untold press being there as well.
The tabloid press was intent on exposing Freddie. November 1990. He was photographed with his GP, Dr. Atkinson. The article described him as haggard and gaunt and asked just what is wrong with Freddie.
It was unusual for him to go to the doctor, actually, but he wanted to get out of the house. And that was just a little trip, and they must have maybe guessed where we were going in the end. But, yeah, towards the end, Fred was seriously frail. It was sad, very sad.
With paparazzi and tabloid hacks hunting him, Freddie almost disappeared from public life.
Once word leaked out, it was a great story. As horrible it is to say it, it was a great story. So it's natural that the speculation just grew and grew and grew.
In the lead up to his death, it wasn't British tabloid press not at their best. It wasn't a great moment for those guys in Fleet Street who were trying to get whatever they could get as a last picture.
I couldn't even park the car without people being all over me and physically all over me, and I just had enough of it. So I thought, oh, this is... If we want to play games, let's play games.
Jesus Christ, this place is if we just drape it?
Phoebe and Jim have got a mannequin, put one of Fred's coats on it.
Can't have him looking scruffy. That.
Get the hat.
Yeah.
And buttons.
No?
No.
Take
no.
the legs. Come okay. on. Jeez.
You got it?
Go.
Okay. Oh. Got it?
Thank you, Terry.
I opened the garage and basically bibbed the hooter and put my foot down.
Freddy, come on, move!
Nearly taken out a few reporters and sped off round the corner. And I took the mannequin round Hyde Park for half an hour. Just to... it was our amusement in the house and it went down very well.
One, two... One,
Freddie
one.
Was very ill, but still working long days in the studio.
You all right, Freddie?
Yes, I'm fine, darling. I'm okay.
Okay, Freddie, shall we do Days of Our Lives?
Yes, let's go for a take.
Great. Do you want to go now?
Yes, I think we should go for a take.
Okay, Freddie.
These Are the Days of Our Lives has become a song that's synonymous with Freddie's final days and his signing off and his goodbye to the world. And... he wasn't ready to go, but he came to terms with it. I think he came to terms with it in that song.
May 1991. Behind-the-scenes footage from the promo shoot for the single revealed a frail Freddie.
That was an incredibly hard day for him. He was, like, in so much pain on his foot and everything. He didn't give in and he'd done it, but as you see with the makeup, He looked very, very ill. Sometimes I get to feel
I was back in the old days. The promo was shot in black and white to try to mask Freddie's illness, but it was still obvious.
Emaciated and sick, and he looked dead to me already, actually. He looked dead in that video for that song.
It was his last performance on camera. The single wasn't released in the UK until after his death. I still
love you. Freddie was gone already. That was just the shell saying goodbye. I still love you.
September 1991. Freddie Mercury was losing his fight against the HIV virus and AIDS.
So, you bequeathed to Mary the house and contents?
Yes, yes.
And, yes. Jim?
500,000.
Peter?
500,000.
Terry?
100,000.
And finally, Joe?
500,000.
Good. The share of the residuary, 50% to Mary, 25% to your sister.
Yes, yes.
And 25% to your mum and dad. Correct?
Yes.
Okay. And last but not least, you're happy for me and John Libson to act as executors and trustees.
Yes, yes, Jim.
Okay, I think that's everything.
Freddie's body was now becoming overwhelmed with the AIDS virus.
As an individual progresses, they become more disabled. So there could be wasting of the muscles and fat, there could be loss of vision or reduced vision, reduced brain function. So people can have a whole range of different deteriorations that mark the end of their life.
Okay.
November 1991. Freddie was practically bedbound.
We was there to make sure his last period of time went as normally as it could do. We would all do our little bit with him, go up, sit on the bed, talk to Fred. I don't think he could eat at the time, so Joe and Phoebe would just make cold watermelon juices for him and things like that. He'd lost so much weight and basically skin and bone. It was very sad.
No, please don't. I can't take it anymore, darling. It's over. It's over. No.
He decided to stop taking medication to fight the virus.
I can't take it anymore. I can't. I think you should call... call Gordon. Call Dr. Atkinson. And call Mary, too. It's over, darling.
From now on, he would just take a powerful oral painkiller, diamorphine.
And after that, he went down quite quickly. And that's when we had the press camping outside. And they was there all the time, and they were horrible. They would give him no free time at all. They were a pack of wolves outside, waiting for the carcass to come out.
November 22nd, 1991. Freddie had kept the secret of his AIDS diagnosis for 4.5 years. But now, he suddenly decided to make a statement.
Fred was getting so much bad press. I think they had to do it just to maybe sort of calm the waters for a little while, because it didn't. They were still camped outside.
Come on, Freddie, we've got to do this. Following the enormous conjecture in the press over the last 2 weeks, I wish to confirm that I have been tested HIV positive and have AIDS. I felt it correct to keep this information private to date, to protect the privacy of those around me. Anything else? This needs to go. How about it's time for the world to know the truth?
The statement took 5.5 hours to craft. It was issued late the following day.
Faithful.
Sunday, 24th of November.
As the immune system becomes very weak, people effectively get overwhelmed by infections, whether they're viral infections, fungal infections, bacterial infections, that cause the death of that individual.
He's asleep.
Has he had the diamorphine?
Yes.
Okay. He's in a coma, and he'll lapse in and out until the end.
It won't be long.
Fred was in a terrible state. He was in and out of sleep. But on the night, I'd been there for, I don't know, 10, 12 days and not been home. And so we said, I'll go home.
He woke up. He wants to go to the toilet. And we were lifting him. And
he's gone.
At 7:01, Dr. Gordon Atkinson pronounced Freddie Mercury dead, attributing his death to bronchopneumonia resulting from advanced AIDS. Three days later, he was cremated. The next day, Joe Haynes of the Daily Mirror made an extraordinary attack on Freddie. He was sheer poison, a man bent, an apt word in the circumstances, on abnormal sexual pleasures. His private life is a revolting tale of depravity, lust, and downright wickedness. For his kind, AIDS is a form of suicide. Now, AIDS is no longer a death sentence, and attitudes to sexual difference have softened. But then, it's no wonder Freddie Mercury had to play the Great Pretender.
Oh, yes, I'm the Great Pretender.
The Great Pretender sums him up the best. And that performance, which is so memorable, there was a real truth about that delivery. The real Freddie shone through. And you couldn't watch that video or hear that song and not know who he really was and what he was trying to say. He'd been a pretender all his life.
Had Freddie lived, the Great Pretender would have been 70 this year.
I don't have any aspirations to live to 70. And as far as I'm concerned, I mean, I have lived a full life. And if I'm dead tomorrow, yeah. I'm going to be dead.
Yeah.
I really have done it all.
Catch 20 moments that rock the 80s next. And it was a decade that lost another great music icon. From her battle with anorexia to drug abuse, we take a look at the life and death of Karen Carpenter in Goodbye to Love. Catch that Tuesday at 10.
Potato.